Bienvenue à toutes et à tous aujourd'hui au troisième café scientifique qui est organisé avec Ivado, par Ivado et le comité intersectoriel étudiant.
Allô?
Je m'appelle Laura, je suis coprésidente de ce comité étudiant. Premièrement, au nom de tout ce comité, notre équipe, un grand merci à nos trois présentateurs aujourd'hui. On a très hâte de vous écouter. Donc, si vous ne connaissez pas encore notre comité étudiant, on est un groupe de sept étudiants boursiers et boursières Rivado de HEC, Polytechnique et Université de Montréal. Et notre mandat, c'est vraiment de représenter toute la communauté étudiante Rivado et de vous soutenir. Et ça comprend tous les étudiants qui sont intéressés par ou qui travaillent dans le milieu de l'intelligence numérique au Québec. Et donc, on organise des événements comme ces cafés scientifiques une fois par mois. Et puis, comme Alexandre a mentionné, on a aussi notre compétition, mon projet de recherche Ivado en 180 secondes. Donc, vous pouvez toujours participer à voir cette compétition, c'est ce jeudi. Et si vous êtes intéressé par le domaine d'intelligence numérique, on a notre page Facebook du comité. Et on a aussi une infolettre, donc vous pouvez vous inscrire à l'infolettre étudiant pour avoir nos nouvelles, voir tous nos événements, nos initiatives. Et si vous avez des questions par rapport à Ivado, des questions par rapport à la vie étudiante en intelligence numérique ou même des suggestions pour nous, parce qu'on est là pour vous représenter, vous aider, vous pouvez nous écrire sur Facebook ou nous envoyer un courriel. On va lister tous nos. Les liens qu'on a mentionnés dans le chat en bas aussi aujourd'hui. Donc, je vois qu'Alexandre a déjà mis les liens pour la page Facebook. Donc, avec ça, je vous souhaite un excellent webinaire. Puis, je vais passer, juste avant de passer la parole à Prof. Carvalho, je crois avec les trois présentateurs, ce serait peut-être mieux d'avoir les questions juste à la fin. Donc, pour donner la chance à tout le monde de bien présenter. Donc, on aura les questions à la fin. Donc, merci d'être là, puis bon webinaire.
Okay. Donc, je peux partager mon écran avec vous. Maintenant, vous devrez voir mon écran. Oui, merci pour la confirmation. Donc, avant de commencer, je veux remercier le comité intersectoriel étudiant Ivado pour l'invitation. C'est un grand plaisir de parler sur mon équipe. En fait, des choses que j'aime beaucoup. Je suis super fière de mon équipe. Donc, c'est bon d'avoir du temps pour parler sur un sujet très intéressant. Aussi, félicitations pour l'activité. Je pense que c'est une super importante activité pour la communauté. Et donc, maintenant, je vais changer pour l'anglais parce qu'il y a beaucoup de mots de recherche qui n'ont pas de traduction, mais je suis confortable et si vous avez des questions, si vous avez des questions en français, portugais, en anglais, je peux les répondre. C'est avec grand plaisir. So, thank you everyone for coming to the presentation of our team. So, I'm going to start by speaking about who we are, what is our context, what are our offices, what do we study, what is our background. And then I will speak about two research projects that I have been working for a long time and that I really love. And after, I will give the word to Caroline and Federico to speak about what they have been doing within our team. A very, very, very important element for our team, and especially for the inclusion and to welcome my students, is C-Health. So C-Health is a research center, the largest one in transportation and logistics in the world. So C-Health has their offices in Université Laval and Université de Montréal. So that's where my students get their office, in Université de Montréal, within the C-Health headquarters. And C-Health puts together a huge amount of members, professors from all universities in Quebec and also international members. We have many, many students. So this is a perfect environment for my students to find peers for scientific activities. We have lots of seminars. We have workshops. So for instance, that is one that is very interesting around November that is about how do you write a paper. We also have IT support. So when my students need computational power for servers or they have problems with the laptops, there is a support. So this is C-Health is a special, a very important element for our team. In terms of who we are, so to start with, we are from very different continents. So we almost have one representative from each continent. And when I say here team, I'm seeing exactly the students that I directly supervise. Now, if I add the collaborators, so that means, there's a delay. That means the professors that work with us and other researchers, postdocs, and so on. We cover a bit more of the world. So we are a very diverse team in what concerns our nationalities, but also in what is our background. So we have engineering, computer scientists, mathematicians, and also we are at different levels of our education. So there are 2 postdocs currently, 3 PhDs, and 7 masters. And the fact that we have more than half of the members as masters leads me to talk about 3 very important values that we try to promote in our share, that is equity, diversity, and inclusion. So to go a bit back, so we are supported by NSERC and the FRQ Ivado share. And our goal is to get diversity to start with. Why diversity? Because if we have people that think about different things and they face different problems, we can do science that is important for more people in our society than just the people that get to do research. And in fact, to get diversity, unfortunately, we need to go lower, let's say, in the chain of education. So as higher you go, in other words, in PhD, postdocs, professors, the less diversity you see. And that's one of the reasons why we have many masters and why do I recruit many masters is to attract more people, more diverse set of people to our team. Then the inclusion part means we care about everyone's success. So we try to meet now with COVID, we try to get to know each other and meet more frequently within our team. And C-Health, again, when we could physically go to our offices was a very important element to also include each one of us with other students, with other professors and so on. And then there is also the element of research. Also what we do has a lot to do with promoting a better society. So to implement more equity in the society we live. So this was about our team and our context. And now let me give you a bit of idea of what research do we do. And if I talk about the core fundamental elements in mathematics that we use, we do a lot of optimization. So we care about problems where people have to take decisions. So we call them decision makers, and they want to take the optimal decision. So we are used to solve these kind of problems. And in particular, we really love games that are decision problems where there are more people and we need to interact and anticipate what they are going to do. So that adds a bit of complexity in what we do. And we also really love combinatorial optimization problems. So that means problems in which people have to take discrete solutions, decisions. So for instance, if I am an hospital manager and I have to decide how many doctors I'm going to recruit, I cannot recruit 5.5 doctors because that's impossible. I have to recruit 5 or 6. So there are many natural problems where the combinatorics, the discrete decisions play an important role. And so the research and the methodologies we work on take this element into account. And there is a vast set of fields of application of our research. Federico is going to talk about our applications in matching markets. And I'm also going to talk about the matching market in a few minutes. And Caroline, she's going to talk about the subject that is associated with somehow allocation of public goods and sustainability. And we also do some things in neural networks and machine learning. And I can talk a bit further about this if there are questions after. But otherwise, I'm going to spend a bit more time talking about 2 of our research projects. Before going there, let me explain why do we care about optimization and game theory, and it's just not for sake of doing beautiful mathematics, but it's also for sake of applicability. So when we do decision maker in game theory, so there is interaction of a different decision, rational decision makers, there is the mathematical challenge, that is, I think that my opponent thinks that I think, and so on, so this complicates life. But if we are able to handle these situations, we can help and in developing supporting tools for policymakers. And who can be policymakers? Can be governments, where they have to anticipate that if they allocate in a certain way public goods, that's going to have an effect in the population. If they decide about certain tax schemes and incentives to companies, that's going to lead to maybe their innovation or maybe the formation of monopolies or oligopolies. So anticipating how the government's decisions impact our society is very important. But for that, we need to account for behavior, and game theory gives us tools to account for this. So this is why we care about these kind of problems. And if you want a very high level way to have an introduction to game theory, I give you here three possibilities. So Beautiful Mind is a movie that talks about the life of an important and very celebrated researcher in game theory that is called John Nash. So he's, if you do game theory, the main thing that you will hear about are about Nash equilibria. And he was the person writing and developing a lot in this direction in game theory. It has a lot of fiction also, this movie. The Liar's Game is a Japanese manga TV series that is amazing in explaining very well game theory principles. So if you want to learn more and you have time, because this is a series so it demands more time, this is also a very good way to start thinking in a strategical way. And then there is this mini TV series that are documentaries that is called The Trapped, where they talk about strategical behavior within political affairs, namely how game theory was important during the Cold War between US and Russia. So again, this is a very, very nice topic, although it's a bit old, it's from 2007, but still it speaks about past and still very recent past. And it shows how game theory can be important in understanding some things that happen in our history, our old history. Now I'm going to jump about one of my favorite research projects that is called, that has to do with kidney exchange programs. So in Canada, we have this program called Kidney Exchange, and it is about helping people that that suffer from renal failure. So their kidneys don't work. And when our kidneys don't work, we really need treatment. We cannot live without them. So either we need to go almost every day to an hospital to have a machine that does the job of a kidney, or we get a transplant. And in fact, we can get transplants for people that are alive. Why? Because each of us normally has two kidneys, and so we can donate one and still live a happy life. So in the kidney exchange programs, we have pairs, so patients that need a kidney and a person that is a friend or a relative willing to donate a kidney to this person. And if they are compatible, they just donate. Otherwise, they are registered in this program with other pairs that are also incompatible. And then we just need to solve a combinatorial problem. That is, how can we swap donors such that patients find compatible donors and we do transplants in a successful way? So for instance, here we will have two pairs that are incompatible, and this donor is compatible with this patient, this donor is compatible with this patient, so they will just swap donors, we could do the transplantation, and everyone will be happy. So this is a combinatorial problem, and becomes a game theory combinatorial problem when we think that we could have this kind of programs between different countries, and therefore potentially help more people. So here we have country A and country B. In the left, we have the national transplants for country A, in the left, the national transplants for country B, and in the horizontal, we have the transplants, the international transplants between these two countries. So in this special case, we will help everyone, but there are cases where this does not happen. But the main point here to take into account that these countries, they want to help their citizens first. They don't care directly about the overall number of patients receiving a kidney, but about their patients. So this becomes a strategical problem where we have to be sure that the countries participating get a good outcome from these programs, and therefore we need to use game theory. So this is one of the lines of research we are exploring. And while I was exploring this, in fact, I realized that there can be multiple optimal ways to help patients. So in fact, Gunush, William, Behrouz, and I, we went to the kidney exchange programs in Canada and US, and we generate these programs with up to 70 patients needing a kidney, so 70 incompatible patient donor pairs. And we saw there were thousands of optimal solutions leading to the same number of transplants. And then the question comes, which solution do we decide to pick? Because they will help different people, and therefore this decision has a huge impact in people's lives, so we need to take a fair decision. So let me give you a concrete example. So in the example that we are going to see, we have six pairs, and in the figures, I have the patients that need a kidney. So we need a pirate that needs a kidney, a captain that needs a kidney, and so on. And these arcs, they are saying that the donor of the pirate is compatible with this patient in disguise. And now we want to maximize the number of transplants by swapping donors. So a solution could be this one in pink, okay? And we will help 5 people, or it could be this one in pink, where again, we save 5 people. So we have 2 optimal solutions, the one in the left and in the right, where the main difference is we need to decide with helping the kid or helping the queen. And now what should we do? So, well, there are 2 hypotheses. One is to try to understand with the doctors what is ethically their preference or cultural preference, or the solution that we come up that doesn't need this, and we call it individual fairness, where we try to have a process to select among these solutions that is fair. So we don't say right away what is going to be the outcome, help the kid or the key or the king, but we associate the probability of selecting this decision and this one. In fact, the possibility could be with probability 1/2. We pick the one in the left, 1/2 the one in the right, and now we maximize the probability of the kid and the queen being a solution. And in this way, we have a process that is fair. And we see this problem in the context of transplant, but in other problems in healthcare, where we need to decide who's going to have priority receiving a treatment, we might need to have a process that is fair when there are multiple optimal solutions, and we should not just leave this to our computer science software to decide. As computer scientists, we should have power about what our algorithms are saying. So this is another project we have. And now just to end, I'm going to talk about interdiction games. So this is a very important kind of model for criminology problems. And they are usually games played in a graph. And in this graph, we have a player that we call the attacker that tries to damage our network. So we can think that the attacker is going to put a virus or a fire in these 2 vertices. And then over time, this virus or fire spreads to the neighborhood. So in time two, it will spread to the neighbors, time three, through the neighbors of the neighbors, and so on and so forth. And because the graph is fully connected, the full graph will have a virus. But now we, as the defender player, we can vaccinate. And after an attack, we can protect vertices. So vaccination means these vertices cannot be attacked anymore. Protection means these vertices, the attack will not pass through these vertices. So for instance, you could think about firefighters fighting a fire, and the fire doesn't pass this barrier of firefighters. In fact, there is a very connected problem with this one. If you search about articles on that, it's called the firefighter problem. So now in this graph, we could vaccinate these 2 vertices, then there is an attack, then we decide our protection. And now when we see the fire spreading, we see that we were able to save 14 vertices, so the one in white. And so the goal of these games is to decide what is our optimal vaccination strategy. So these problems, like I said, they are very related with well-known problems in computer science, like the firefighter problem, cop and robbers problem. But this is also interesting from the application point of view, because we can think about these viruses, fake news being spread on social networks, or malware being spread in botnets. And so this gives us the base to start tackling this kind of attacker problems. In terms of what is the mathematics we use, well, we can use combinatorial optimization, but we also, because these problems theoretically, they are extremely, extremely hard to solve, we started to use tools from machine learning to develop good ways to solve these kinds of games. And again, this is a very fruitful kind of research and a project with non-stop open questions, and so that we are very interested to attack. So now I will pass the word to Caroline and Federico, but before, let me advertise a workshop in game theory that's going to be open to our community and is promoted by CRM and also supported by Ivado. It's going to be in November, so if you want to know more about game theory, maybe you want to keep note of this workshop. So thank you very much.
Hello, everyone. Can I take over?
Sure, Caroline.
Okay, I'll share my screen. Do you see the presentation?
Yes.
Yes? Okay, great. Let's move this. So thank you for the introduction, Margarita, and for the invitation to this event. I'm really happy that I get the chance to talk about my master's research project, which is supervised by the amazing Professor Margarita. So first, I'll introduce myself quickly. I have a bachelor's in mathematics and actuarial science from University of Montreal, and I worked 4 years in the field before deciding to go back to school and follow my passion for coding and data science and mathematics. And during my studies, I gained increasing interest for machine learning and operations research. And I was hoping to engage in projects which can benefit the environment, public health, and the common good. So given my background and my encounter with Margarita, combined with the increasing need to seek for environmental and sustainable policies, I was happy to join Margarita's research team in the attempts to answer the question, how can we make use of data science to improve the decision-making process for greening cities? Our problem can be expressed as an optimization problem and can easily be compared to the facility location problem. So we have a set of potential green spaces, sites G, and a set of neighborhoods N, and the problem is to select a subset of green space G, so that every neighborhood or individual can have access to a park. So the facility location problem is mostly concerned in minimizing the distance from customers to specific facility sites. Whereas in our case, our goal will be to maximize the fairness. And the objective function will be submitted to multiple constraints as for any optimization problem, such as budget limitation, distances, and the maximum number of selected green spaces for each user, so for each citizens. Now, how can we maximize fairness in an optimization problem? Our first idea for now is to minimize the difference between the distance from an individual to a green space and the total average distances for all individuals. So that's not just minimizing the distance, it's really to minimize the variance and make sure that someone from a poorer neighborhood is not really far from a green space, whereas in a richer neighborhood, people are closer to the parks. Also, we can try to spread evenly the public investments among neighborhoods. And also, it'd be important to prioritize neighborhoods which are currently disadvantaged, who severely lack green space, and who suffer extreme heat waves during the summertime. Those are called heat islands. So when you lack trees and green spaces, then there is an extremely big amount of heat that is concentrated in an area. And this increases the pollution and decreases the quality of life.
In the optimization problem, we also want to integrate a model for the citizen's behavior. So in order to assess how does the citizen choose to visit a park based on their preference, on their profile, well, this can be done using two models that we've selected for now. First, we have the discrete choice models. And secondly, we'll talk about machine learning. Discrete choice models is a really powerful tool because its structure is flexible enough to make it really accurate and match really citizens' behavior and how they visit the parks. For example, random utility model allow us to model a citizen's choice of a park based on the park's future and the citizen's characteristics, while also including a random component. And the randomness makes the choice really realistic because this is not a predefined decision and it's not deterministic. On the other hand, machine learning could be useful if we gather a significant amount of data about parks' visits history. But the interpretation is often difficult to assess because it's like a black box. And we have some concerns related to the data and the technical limitations, which could make it hard to use the ML algorithms in our context. So in order to integrate the citizen's choice of a park in the model, we've added an additional objective to maximize the citizen's utility when selecting a park among the available choices. So given that our first objective of maximizing fairness reflects the city's position, so the policymaker, like Margarita mentioned before, and the second objective is from an individual citizen's perspective, the optimization problem can now be structured using a bi-level programming formulation, also known as a Stackelberg games in the game theory. So in our case, the city acts as the leader and the citizens as the followers. So the leader sets the rules and the followers will react according to the leader's actions. The leader will choose, in our case of the greening cities, they will choose to install parks at specific locations to maximize the fairness among individuals, and the followers will react to their decision by selecting the park that maximizes their utility, so maximizes their happiness and individual preferences. So some of the modeling complexity, first, well, the decision to install a park in the city will be laid out in multiple years. So the decision of 1 year will impact the decisions of the second year and so on. So this will really increase the difficulty to solve the problem. Then the fact that the choices of the individuals are random, this will include a lot of stochasticity in the model and will enhance the difficulty of solvability. Also, some constraints related to budget or maximum tolerable distance could make the problem infeasible. So it'll be important to have constraints which enhance the fairness of individuals, but that makes the problem also feasible. And finally, the computation complexity, since the problem can be very large due to the large number of individuals and neighborhoods, this will make the problem complex to solve. So in the end, our goal is to propose a methodology to find the optimal decision. And our model will be applied to the specific case of Montreal City, since we have access to experts in urban planning and health. And this project is one of many which aims to show how data science can be used in governmental decisions for the common good. So I hope you enjoy the presentation because I'm really happy to be working on this project. And please let me know if you have any question later. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. Congratulations, Caroline. Very beautiful. And Margarita, of course. So I'll be talking about assigning optimally scholarships from the student's perspective. This is a part of a joint work with Margarita, Andrea, and Alfredo. So let us take in consideration the standard university admission problem. This is a very vanilla kind of problem. We have, the framework is a bipartite graph on the left, we have universities like University C, University M, D, and Q. And on the right, we have students like Mia, Lee, Amy, Nish, and Bob. So each university has ranks the students, and not necessarily completely. So for example, University C ranks first Nish, then Lee, then Mia, and fourth Amy. And on the other side, Mia ranks first University D, then M, C, and Q. The edges mean that the feasibility of the matching. Basically, Mia could be enrolled into the four universities, while Bob could be enrolled only in University D. So this problem has been extensively studied in the past decades by many researchers, and some of them were even awarded the Nobel Prize in economics for their contribution. The university admission problem is within the field of matching theory, which can be studied from many different perspectives. So for example, from the perspective of computer science, we may be interested in computing algorithms that provide us solutions, optimal solutions, and we may be also interested in understanding the computational complexity of the problem that we are studying, of the instance of the problem that we are tackling. From the perspective of economics, we may be interested in the game theoretic aspect of the behavioral interaction between the universities and the students. For example, the universities may disclose shorter preference list in order to obtain more preferred students. So it has been established, for example, that usually in the normal university admission problem, it is convenient for the student to disclose the longest possible preference list. But there are even cases in which it is preferable for them to disclose a very, very short and sometimes even fake preference list. From the perspective of optimization, instead, sometimes, you know, to get an application, you may be interested in understanding which is the goal function and which are the constraints that we wish to implement in the problem that we are tackling, which is related to the matching theory problem. So the problem of the university admission is not only interesting from the point of view of mathematics, of theoretical mathematics, but also from the point of view of applications. One of the most famous applications of the university admission problem, as the name says, is admitting students into elementary school, high school, universities, residents to hospitals, and even military cadets, even though I'm pacifist, to military posts and schools. And these algorithms are very much implemented, like millions of students every year across the world are admitted into universities and schools thanks to these algorithms. But not only for educational purposes, but also for social networks like dating applications. So if you still didn't get the right matching on Tinder, we can try to fix that mathematically. or maybe even, you know, ride sharing like Lyft or Uber. And of course, this is very important. I mean, like online advertisement, like Google. So if you have to assign advertisement in a web page, and they use the tools of matching theory and also the university admission problem. Very interestingly, this framework is also used to enforce the supply chain. So let's go back to the students' optimal to the previous example, and let us compute what is called the students' optimal stable matching, which basically means that the students are assigned into the best possible universities among all the possible stable matchings. So in this case, and let us also assume that the four universities, they all have capacity one. So Mia goes to University D, Lee goes to University C, Amy to University M, and Nish goes to University Q. Unfortunately, Bob, he remains unenrolled. And we are very sorry for Bob, but luckily real life sometimes is better than theory. And which means that in the real life, there are also some scholarships, right? So for example, like IVADO or the Ministry of Education of Quebec or Fonds National de Recherche du Québec, right? They provide scholarships and fundings to universities in order to improve the quality of education provided to the students, right? So let's assume that Ivado is assigning a scholarship and should decide to which university should we assign a scholarship, right? And perhaps Ivado decides, okay, let's assign this scholarship to University D. And if Ivado assigns a scholarship to University D, Bob will be able to attend, to pursue higher education. The very interesting thing in this problem, when one of the many interesting things, is that if it chooses the institution, which could be Ivado, the Front National Library Research, to Quebec, or the Ministry of Education of Quebec, decide instead to assign a scholarship to University C, M, or Q, then Bob will still remain unassigned. That's because the other university do not rank Bob. So this raises a natural question, which is very interesting, which is how should Ivado, the whatever, right, assign award scholarships or fundings to universities optimally? What does it mean optimally? Optimality depends on the goal function that we choose. And for example, for the sake of simplicity, but we could also choose the dual one, we could choose optimizing the quality of the assignment for the students, which in our particular case means, because it's the university admission problem, increasing the quality of the education provided to the students, which is a noble goal, right? So we have this goal, and we may wish to think about several policies to implement this goal, to obtain our goal. For example, a policy could be the level up policy. So maybe among the students, there are certain universities which are perceived as less popular, right? So if we assign them scholarships, maybe those will, the scholarship will increase the quality of the education in this university. Or perhaps we may be willing to, Ivado or whatever, may be willing to adopt a kind of monopoly policy in the sense of awarding the scholarship to the most popular university, in this way to enforce the popularity of the university. So the super interesting news, and this is one of the beauties of mathematics, is that there are instances of in which the level up policy is optimal. There are other instances in which the monopoly policy is optimal. And there are instances in which both policies are suboptimal. And this fact tells us something very important. That is that this problem, this combinatorial problem, is definitely not trivial, which for a mathematician is a good news because it makes it interesting, right? So we have just proved that the problem of assigning optimal scholarships to university is NP-hard, which means basically, in simple words, that to compute an exact solution may take a huge amount of time. That is why we are now working on developing an approximation algorithm. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Thank you, Federico. Merci, Federico. Somebody have question? Est-ce que quelqu'un a des questions? Je vous rappelle qu'on est en mode Zoom, Zoom réunion. Donc, tout le monde peut simplement ouvrir son micro pour poser des questions. Donc, félicitations déjà à Margarita, à Federico et à Caroline pour leur présentation. Je crois que nous avons des questions dans le chat. Est-ce que Chloé, tu veux prendre la parole?
Oui, tout à fait. J'étais en train de... je vais peut-être poser la question en français parce que je ne suis pas totalement sûre de bien m'exprimer en anglais là-dessus. Mais par rapport au problème que vous présentiez tout à l'heure, Margarita, c'était très intéressant, je trouvais, par rapport à la donation... De reins, etc. Et je me demandais si, par exemple, une personne se voit refuser une donation dans laquelle elle était intriquée, est-ce que la prochaine fois qu'elle est confrontée à ce genre de problème, elle aura une chance qui va être un peu augmentée ou pas d'avoir un résultat positif?
Oui, ça c'est une super très bonne question parce que j'ai déjà pensé sur ce type de problème et en effet il est naturel parce que ce graphe de compatibilité il est fait d'une façon virtuelle. Donc en effet une fois que par exemple je suis assigné une donneur, on va voir si on est effectivement compatible et en effet ma compatibilité peut changer pendant le temps et peut-être aussi si je suis très malade, je ne suis pas plus capable de faire le transplant maintenant. Donc ça peut arriver. Donc je ne suis pas complètement sûre. Sur tous les programmes de donation de reins au monde, mais lesquels que je connais, il n'existe pas une priorité qu'on donne à ce patient qui on a dit oui, on a un transplant et après, oh non, on n'a pas plus. Je pense que c'est cette situation que ta question est sur. Donc, ça n'existe pas, au moins explicitement. J'ai lu beaucoup de règles de comment ce programme fonctionne au Canada, dans l'Europe, etc. Et ça n'existe pas. Mais il existe une préoccupation, et en effet, ça existe au Canada, de on prend la décision que je vais recevoir un transplant, par exemple, mais après, on voit que le donneur n'est pas plus disponible, par exemple. Donc, le Canada, il essaye de trouver une autre donneur dans ce moment. Comment est-ce que je peux expliquer? Donc, dans l'exemple que j'ai montré, j'avais plusieurs solutions et il se peut voir qu'il y a une façon de récupérer un autre transplant. Donc, par exemple, j'étais avec une cycle avec Federico, donc j'utilise les images que je vois ici. Donc, moi, Federico, toi, moi. Donc, on avait une cycle de 3 personnes à soi et un transplant. Et maintenant, Federico n'est pas plus disponible. Peut-être il existe une compatibilité entre ton donneur et mes donneurs et on peut faire cette transplant. Donc, ça s'appelle recovery. Donc, en effet, il existe ce processus d'essayer de faire la recovery de transplant. Donc, si on va, par exemple, lire le rapport sur le programme de donation de rein au Canada, il montre toute cette situation où on a dit, oh, cette personne va recevoir un transplant, mais après, il n'est pas plus possible. Comment est-ce qu'on était capable de récupérer ou non? Et j'ai fait travail sur cela. Et ça, c'est un des problèmes très typiques en optimisation qui s'appelle optimisation robuste, qui ça veut dire s'il y a un problème avec notre solution optimale, est-ce qu'on peut faire des petits changes pour faire la récupération? Est-ce que j'ai bien expliqué?
Oui, OK. Mais OK, ça me rassure un peu parce que je me disais si à chaque fois c'était 50-50. À chaque fois que quelqu'un est impliqué dans ça, c'est 50-50, je me disais, fatalement, il va peut-être y avoir des gens qui n'ont pas de chance à chaque fois et qui ne se retrouvent jamais sans donner.
Ah,
ok, donc en fait...
Ok, donc tu parles d'une autre situation, c'est des personnes qui ne sont pas dans une solution optimale.
Tu parlais de la situation où il y avait the queen, et je ne sais plus, et je me disais, si la personne se fait refuser une fois, deux fois, trois fois, et à chaque fois, en fait, elle est... dans quelque chose qui est de 50-50, la chance de l'avoir, je me disais, ça peut devenir injuste au bout d'un moment. Ça fait 6 fois qu'elle pourrait avoir un don et en fait, manque de chance, elle ne l'a pas eu.
C'est ça. Ok, ok. Donc, c'est différent. J'ai pensé que c'est le problème où on planifie une chose et on dit à la personne, tu vas recevoir un transplant et après, il y a ce coup émotionnel de dire, ah, la transplantation n'est pas possible. Non, dans ce cas, il existe beaucoup d'études dans en recherche, mais dans le point de vue appliqué, je ne vois pas jamais. Je pense qu'il n'est pas maintenant implémenté, qui est de donner plus de priorité à les personnes qui sont à attendre plus de temps. Oui, ça c'est une chose naturelle à faire, mais maintenant les programmes normalement ils donnent plus de priorité à la personne qui sont par exemple en 200 ans. C'est de savoir qu'il est plus difficile de trouver des donneurs compatibles. Donc, on donne plus de priorité à ces personnes, mais pas vraiment à les personnes qui attendent plus de temps, pour beaucoup de temps. Mais ça existe à le niveau de la recherche, mais pas au niveau de l'implémentation.
D'accord. Merci.
Génial. On a aussi Laura. Est-ce que tu peux prendre le micro?
Yes, thank you so much. Your presentations were very, very clear and very interesting. So thank you. My question is a bit wide, but maybe Caroline and Federico, you can maybe answer for specifically your projects. I was wondering about your data that you use. You must use a lot of data for each project. How do you know when to stop collecting data? Or because you can have millions of factors that influence your solutions, how do you know that you have enough factors, enough data? And is ethics a big limitation when you collect your data and plan your project? Like, you're maybe not allowed, or there's certain factors or information that can cause a bias. How do you organize all that and deal with it? Thank you.
I can give an answer, but maybe I think Federica and Carolina potentially want to add something, for sure. But in fact, for now, the problem is always the reverse. There is not enough data, so we still didn't face that problem of knowing when to stop. But talking about the transplantation problem, that's a big issue. In fact, getting data, because there is the fact that we should not be able to identify patients, which I completely understand. And so this is more a problem on how to write and demand request data such that we, for instance, when I asked that about the patients that are in Canadian kidney exchange programs, I have to be sure that I ask only elements that will never be able for me to identify a patient, otherwise they will say no. So it's more usually the reverse. And our goal in general is, in this kind of healthcare data, is I want to be able to generate instances problems to know that my methodology works. So I want to have enough data so I can create fake data. So I don't need to rely on this one, because this one is very hard to get and time consuming. So usually we are still in the problem of getting good data and not having too much data that you say, no, we are happy. But I let Federico, Caroline, if you want to add something.
Yeah, I was going to say exactly what Margarita said. So basically the problem is, getting the data, especially there are some agencies like the Canadian, the CARMS is the Canadian Resident Matching Agency that every year assigns like thousands of prospective residents to hospitals, and likewise in the US and in Italy. So when it is not trivial to get data from them, like for the UK, you have even to pay to get their data. But the point is that it is important to ensure that the data that you're going to use are not going to disclose the personal identity of the people who participated to the matching and who made their own applications. And also, I guess, also for not only for the individuals, but also for the institutions, like which are usually the preferences of the institutions across Canada who are willing to admit students from within Canada, but also from the rest of the world. So it's a very good question, and but unfortunately, we are still on the other side of the problem, which is getting data and good quality data, especially.
Puis, je vais répondre en français, si c'est correct. Dans le contexte de comment modéliser le comportement des citoyens quand ils choisissent des parcs. On va sûrement faire appel à des données publiques là, municipales de Montréal. Donc, même l'utilisation des Bixi, comment est-ce que les gens voyagent du point A au B, à B, puis quand le point B, ben, c'est un parc. Puis, en parallèle, on va accumuler des informations agrégées. Donc, plutôt que de venir chercher vraiment de l'information individuelle sur chaque citoyen, on va plutôt les modéliser en tant que quartier. Donc, un regroupement de gens qui partagent des caractéristiques en commune. Donc, ça met moins en jeu l'aspect éthique, parce qu'on les considère comme en groupe, donc plutôt savoir bien, le revenu de cette personne, mais on va juste considérer comme un quartier et le revenu moyen qui est fait dans ce quartier-là. Donc, à ce niveau-là, c'est moins dangereux pour l'aspect éthique de la chose. Ouais.
Merci. On a aussi une question de Guillaume Chiquan. Dans le...
Bonjour. Moi, j'aurais une question pour Caroline. Le modèle que tu nous proposes, il permet d'aller chercher une forme de les meilleurs endroits pour mettre les parcs. Mais une fois qu'on présente ça au, mettons, à la mairie de Montréal, il y a plein d'autres critères qui rentrent en compte. Les élections, par exemple, les budgets répartis par arrondissement ou ce genre de choses. Et donc, comment est-ce qu'on peut passer de ce modèle qui dit voilà la solution objectivement la meilleure pour tous les citoyens et aller vers un autre modèle qui est voilà la solution qui va être la plus acceptable politiquement, la plus acceptable par les citoyens? Est-ce que l'approche naïve de dire ben, on génère ce modèle-là, puis après on va tweaker un peu, puis on va trouver ce qui marche mieux, ça marche? Ou est-ce qu'il faut intégrer toutes ces contraintes politiques dans le modèle lui-même dès le début?
Très bonne question. Margarita voudra sûrement compléter. Dans notre contexte, le problème n'est pas tant de trouver la solution optimale, mais de montrer les méthodologies qui peuvent être utiles pour faire ce genre de décision et de prouver à la ville ou aux policymakers de façon générale, comment est-ce qu'on peut mettre en œuvre la science des données, les grandes bases de données, comment est-ce qu'on peut faire usage de toutes ces ressources qui sont disponibles pour le bien commun, ce qui n'est pas fait de façon courante. Donc, nous, ce qu'on suggère, c'est vraiment une méthodologie qui va évidemment amener un résultat, mais en fonction des contraintes que nous, on a préétablies basées sur nos connaissances. Mais évidemment, les contraintes gouvernementales, politiques seront tout autres et plus complexes, plus importantes. Mais l'idée, ce serait vraiment de faire comme un template, un problème, une formulation d'un problème de base sur lequel on peut rajouter plus de contraintes, de limites qui reflètent mieux la réalité. Est-ce que Margarita
te... Oui, c'est exactement ça. On va être capable de donner une réponse, une solution, une méthodologie, et après aller à la ville de Montréal et les convaincre qu'ils ont besoin de nous pour prendre des meilleures décisions. Ça c'est le but, c'est de dire, oh, prendre attention, on fait des choses intéressantes. Mais sans doute qu'il y a une partie de après de adapter ce modèle à la partie plus la réalité de comment est-ce que les organisations prennent des décisions. Et il y a toute une théorie avec la théorie des jeux, comment est-ce qu'ils prennent la décision, et peut-être il y a différents départements dans la ville de Montréal qui ont des opinions différentes. Donc, est-ce qu'on peut anticiper qu'est-ce qu'il arrive? Mais le problème que Caroline maintenant travaille sur, c'est la base. Et donc, on l'appelle le projet pilote pour attirer l'attention de la ville de Montréal et donc faire quelque chose de plus réel. Mais oui, la question, c'est super important. C'est une des choses qu'on a parlé dans le début, c'est son application, comment est-ce que ça va fonctionner.
L'idée de les résultats sont justes. C'est juste, on veut montrer que ça marche. Et on veut montrer ensuite tous les autres paramètres, on pourra en discuter avec la ville. Exact. Merci.
Exact.
Il est 1h-1, si vous avez, il y aurait peut-être le temps pour une petite question rapide. Je crois que ça a été... Vous avez répondu à toutes les questions de notre auditoire aujourd'hui. Très, très intéressant encore une fois pour ce beau café scientifique. Je passerai peut-être la parole à Laura, mais simplement vous féliciter et vous dire merci pour ces belles présentations aujourd'hui, Margarita, Frédérico, Caroline. Et simplement que je vais vous remettre dans le chat à l'instant les principaux liens pour suivre justement nos prochaines activités étudiantes, IVADO, nos principaux événements et aussi formations que vous allez voir directement sur notre calendrier, y compris l'événement Mon projet de recherche IVADO en 180 secondes qui aura lieu donc jeudi prochain et auquel je vous invite fortement à participer. Laura, je te laisse le petit mot de conclusion au nom du comité intersectoriel étudiant. Puis moi, je vous dis à la prochaine pour un autre événement.
Merci, merci encore beaucoup à vous trois. Puis merci d'avoir très, très bien organisé vos présentations. On a pu terminer à temps et répondre à toutes les questions. Merci beaucoup pour ça, c'est super. Puis au plaisir de vous accueillir toutes parmi nous dans notre communauté. J'espère vous voir le mois prochain et puis dans notre groupe Facebook. Donc, bienvenue et à la prochaine.